My experience with Python in the last years, I have written this book, Mastering Python and Security, with PACT Pub Editorial. And with this book, it covers many topics regarding with security, how the main tools, modules, and packages that we have in Python for detecting vulnerabilities, and in general, what all topics related with security. Also, I have available in my personal gmortega.github.io. I have several other conferences, presentations related with security, microservice, and Docker security, if you are interested. Well, these are the main points of the talk. Basically, in this talk, we will look at tips and techniques for writing secure code in Python and how can we solve the main issues related with dangerous functions that we have in Python. What is, well, we started with security coding. Security coding basically is the practice of software development that guards programs against security vulnerabilities and makes it resistant to malicious attacks right from program design to implementation. As a practice, security coding includes all these branches, but is not limited to analysis of architecture, reviews of implementation details, verification of code logic and systems, operational testing, functional testing, all these, there are many disciplines that are involved in testing, and in this talk, I will center mainly in security. This is a list of known unsafe Python components, where we can highlight, for example, eval, picker, operating system module, subprocess, YAML, all these components, all these packages are the most dangerous and must be aware when we are developing our application with this, when we are using this module. In this talk, we are going to review some of these components, of this package, and analyze why they are dangerous from a security point of view. Certain Python functions, like subprocess, for example, should be only with caution. Python documentation typically includes a note about the dangers of that function in the documentation of the module. In this example, we can see that subprocess module has a shell parameter that can be dangerous if we not validate the input of the command or the parameter of the user or something else. We will discuss a few dangerous categories of Python functions and some alternatives we can use for avoid security risks. This can be the potential issues to watch for dangerous functions like eval or subprocess, as we have seen before. Serialization and deserialization of objects with pickle, and others security issues related with SQL and JavaScript snippets, especially if you are using Django or Flask, is recommended following best practice, using, for example, specific ORMs for persisting in database and Flask templates for avoid problems related with SQL injection or cross-site scripting vulnerabilities. Input, in general, this is in Python, for example, input and output validation and sanitization is one of the most critical and most often found problems relating to security vulnerabilities. In this example, our argument is being passed to a system function considered as insecure without any validation. At this point, it's important to remember that an application that aims to mitigate this type of attack should have filters to check and remove content that can be malicious and only accept data that is reasonable and safe to the application. Python has an eval function which evaluates a string Python code. This function is very dangerous if you set strings to evaluate from and trust input. If you are using eval in your code, it's a good idea to check, for example, which variables and methods the user can use. You can see which variables and methods with using the dir method. With the method we can see that what are the variables and methods available for eval. For example, you can make eval safe by providing with no globals. Eval function takes a second argument, second parameter with which are the global values to use during the evaluation. If you don't provide a globals dictionary, then eval use the current globals. If you provide an empty dictionary, a second parameter, we can see, then there are no globals. And you execute the code, you can see that rise an exception related that the OS module is not defined. Because we are not providing globals, and the OS module is not defined. We can still import, but we can still import modules and use them with the built-in function import. We can use this word. This sentence it works. The worst here is that with a malicious command like rm or list file, we can have a big security hole in our application. The next app then to make things safe is, for example, refuse the access to the built-ins. Before we have seen that with the built-ins we can access to the OS module, for example, but we can disable the built-ins by defining that name as an empty dictionary in our not globals. And now it raises the same error that we have seen before. It's throw a name error exception because we have disabled this feature. Conclusions for eval. Restricting the use for eval by passing globals and local dictionaries will make your code secure, particularly when you are using input provided by the user. In this example, the eval expression can have a SQRT method and only one variable only. All other methods and variables are unavailable for eval. We are restricting the using of a specific method, a specific variable in our eval function. The final conclusion for about eval is not using for code evaluating, but if you have to use it, use eval only with input sources and return values from functions that you have control. Pickle is another of the dangerous functions to evaluate in Python. The Pickle module basically implements binary protocols for serializing and deserializing a Python object structure. Pickle enables you to store state and Python objects to this so that you can later restore them. This module can be useful for storing something that doesn't need a database or for a temporary data. The problem with Pickle is that has the same weakness that eval or su process function. The main problem is that it enables users to craft input that executes arbitrary code in our machine without control. This is an example of using a Pickle function Basically, what is that is to serialize an object in its hierarchy. You simply call the dump function, and for the serialize a data stream, for example, you call the loads function. Here, the exploit class masquerades malicious code into a pickle object, which after unpickle execute the code inside the reduce method and expose the contents of the root folder of the machine to the attacker. Vale. The vulnerability basically occurs when the user supply input is not properly sanitized before passing to the YAML.load or pickle.loads method. The solution at this point is never unpickle data from a untrusted or unauthenticated source. And instead of using pickle, for example, we can use alternative formats for serialized data, like JSON, or safe methods like YAML.safeload method. Instead of using the classical pickle.loads, you can use, for example, YAML.safeload. This is the first approach that we can find in Python for a solution this kind of vulnerability. But if you need to use pickle due to project requirements, for example, the recommendation is using, for example, mitigation strategies like such as shared root jail, the shared root or a sandbox to avoid bad effects of malicious code execution. Use techniques like sandbox software or code jail to create safe environments that prevents execution of malicious code on the system. How can implement this in Python, for example? Here is a modification of the previous code. Now with a simple shared root jail, which prevents code execution on the actual root folder. Basically, it uses a local safe root subfolder as the new root. We create a new root in the system. It's called a safe root subfolder, and this new root is the context manager for the application. At this point, we are using the context manager that creates a sandbox, and we create a method called systemjail that uses a local safe root subfolder as the new root via context manager hook. And we can use this method for serialize and the serialize data using the context manager approach. Other errors that we can find in Python, for example, overflow errors. At this point, we can differentiate two kinds of errors: the classical buffer overflow that we can find in our language, like C, Java, and so on. Basically, the buffer overflow are produced by programming errors that allow an application to write past the end of or the beginning of a buffer. And the buffer overflows allows attackers to take control over system by gaining access to the application stack or heap memory by careful attack data. The other error that is very common is the integer or arithmetic overflow. These errors occur when arithmetic or mathematical operation on integer produce a result that is too less for the maximum state that of the type used to store it, the value. In Python 2, we have these problems with the sRange and range functions. But well, this problem in Python 3 really is fixed. And if you are using Python 3, you have to. To be safe in this aspect, because in Python 3, types int and long are unified into one. We have only int type. Long type is eliminated, and the range object objects manage the memory internally. At this point, I'm going to tell now about the main injections that we have that we can find in our code. Basically, an injection is a uncontrolled use of user input that reaches an interpreter. This could be a SQL interpreter, the command line, or the Python interpreter. It can be whatever. And at this point, we can differentiate two groups, injection attacks, SQL injections and command injections. SQL injection is where you are writing SQL queries directly instead of using a ORM system. And what you are doing is mixing your string literals with variables in the SQL when you are building the queries. And the command injections are very similar to SQL injections, but instead of injecting commands into a database system, these attacks make it possible to inject commands into the, for example, a server server, for example. The dangerous functions, as I commented before, the subprocess, for example, the dangerous function marks as read subprocess.cal, where it can be seen how the parameter is being passed directly to the shell call. And the security issue at this point is that entering a string starting with a command separator made it possible to interact directly with the system cell. The main problem with this function is that with the subprocess.call function is that command is not being escaped before being executed in the shell. The best practice at this point, this is the first that we have to do. This is not only the solution, but it's the first approach that we can use for solution this. The best practice is use the parameter shell equals false. It protects you against most of the risks associated with piping commands to the shell. In this example, we can see that we have two functions, ping unsafe and ping safe. The ping unsafe, where the shell can process other commands that are provided by the user after the ping command terminates. In this case, the user can inject other commands. And the solution in this case, in the ping safe method, rather than passing a string to subprocess, our function is using a list of strings, and the ping command gets each argument separately. So the shell doesn't process other commands that are provided by the user after the ping command terminates. And in this way, we can see how is the best, the most safe method. For a better security in our code, for example, we can use some functions to sanitize or escape the input of the user. For example, in Python, we have, you need, for example, escape the input, you can use the shlex module, which is built into a standard library, and it has a utility function for escaping shell commands. The quote function, only available in Python 3, returns a shell escape version of the string. And the returned value is a string that can safely be used as one token in a shell command line. Also, we can build our own Python module, which helps invoke complex multi-pipe commands. If we need to work with complex commands, for example, we can use develop our own Python function for doing this. In this example, we create a function exec CMD that recursively reads the output from the current process and writes it to the input file descriptor of the next process. This is another approach that can be interesting when we have to use complex command with piping, concatenating commands, and so on. Well, now I'm thinking about the main issues that we have in web applications. The OWASP 10 projects list the most critical web application security flaws, and basically it's a recommendation for applications that check the most 10 critical security flaws. And this talk I will center in injection, in SQL injection, and cross-site scripting. SQL injection vulnerabilities basically allows attackers to modify the structure of SQL queries in ways that allows for data exfiltration or manipulation that, of existing data. In this example, the user has to input the parameter used for filtering the query. And the vulnerability happens when an application creates a query partly or entirely from the user input without sanitizing the user input. And in this case, the user can now change the database or even execute system commands. The best way for avoiding SQL injection is to use parameters in the SQL command. Basically, we can, for example, concatenate constant fragments or SQL literals with parameter placeholders. And for example, instead of using the percent character, we can use an interrogation character to pass in values. This is the easy way to avoid this kind of vulnerability. A common use case is the need, for example, to build parts of the SQL statement dynamically. You need to build your queries in a dynamic way, for example, depending of the user input. There are other techniques, for example, if dynamic SQL is the unique way to build a complex SQL statement, the recommendation is to validate careful the inputs to be concatenating, accepting only valid inputs using, for example, regular expressions, or replacing special charters needed to filter when we are working with SQL statements. The other vulnerability that I'm going to comment is the cross-site scripting. Cross-site scripting occurs in web applications when a site takes and trust data and sends it to other user without sanitation. Without scraping HTML input, the application becomes vulnerable to cross-site scripting attacks. In this example, a malicious user could inject arbitrary JavaScript in the line, for example, where we are when we get the param of the input, and it is inserted into the result page, and a link to the vulnerable web page can be construed and sent to the unknown user who opens the link and get important information stolen of the user. Another of vulnerability that is related with cross-site scripting is, for example, the server-side template injection. This is an attack using the server-side templates of common web frameworks as an attack vector. The attack basically uses weaknesses in the way the user input is embedded on the templates. This attack can be used to figure out internals of a web application, execute shell commands, and even fully compromise the servers. In this image, we can see that we can, for example, evaluate the value of the secret key in the object dictionary, passing in the URL, we are passing the person.secret with braces, and we can see that we can obtain confidential information that is exposed in our application. Also, for example, we are working with flags. For example, we can get the flag configuration by passing the config parameter in the URL. This vulnerability can be dangerous because an attacker can get information that is related with the server configuration. And the application can expose information that can be dangerous for the user. Well, for a solution, this kind of vulnerabilities, cross-site scripting and server-side template injection, we can use flags provide some solutions. An easy way for avoiding these vulnerabilities is to use the template engine or flags. If the template engine was used instead of manually replacing the string, the template engine automatically would sanitize the input for us, and we don't have to. We have to worry about the sanitizer of the input. The correct way to prevent cross-site scripting attacks is to validate the user input and ensure that data rendered by templates is escape. Another solution, also available in Flask, is using the render template string method for inject the parameter in the template. For good measure, we can also make sure that the output is properly escaped by using the escape filter of Jinja templates. In this example, we can see that we are using the Jinja templates for escaping filters for escaping this the information. And in this way, we can ensure that we have no problems with this kind of vulnerabilities. Well, now let's about tooling. I'm going to comment what are the main tools that we have in Python that automatically solve all these problems and shows in reports, information, and so on. The classical tool for avoid SQL injection is SQL map. Also, we have others for XSS Scrapy, that is based in the Scrapy framework. And other tools, this tool is related with source code analysis. What is that? Is inspect the code and detect the source code that can be dangerous in the application. The main tool that I use is Bandit. Bandit is a static code analysis tool designed to find common security issues in Python code. It is written in Python and can be easily extended with your own security policies, integrated with, you have, for example, a a continuous integration, continuous delivery, like Jenkins, you can integrate in the pipelines of Jenkins, for example, only this tool. This is the reference for Scrappy. This tool allows to find vulnerabilities of cross-site scripting and SQL injection. And for example, when we are, these are the main steps that the tool follows for SQL injection process. This is how works SQL map. Basically, with this tool, scans the website, is analyzed to find vulnerabilities, starting for simple information, and what it does is detecting first try. What this does is first searching information about the domain. If it found that the URL can be vulnerable to a SQL injection, it has the capacity to extract information about tables, columns, searching data, and so on. Basically, the tool to do this, and the tool allows requests to the parameters of the URL that are indicated, and detect and have the capacity to detect is some parameters of the domain is vulnerable because the parameters are not being validated currently, and you can discover table names, download database, perform SQL queries automatically, and so on. Well, this is the tool that I'm going to center now, Bandit. For me, it's the most useful tool for starting with this topic. And well, the most interesting tool, the most interesting of this tool is that we can customize this tool with plugins and extend the capabilities of this tool. Basically, it's an open source, it's a command line tool where only is mandatory the source file or directory to be test. And basically, it's a tool that can connect information about user input and sensitive code to detect when the operations performed are dangerous. Bandit supports many different tests to detect various security issues in the Python code. These are the main plugins that we can find that are created in a tool, but we can extend this and create our own plugins to test the code. This is the blacklist by default that comes with Bandit. This blacklist data checks for a number of Python modules known to have possible security implications. For example, it detects the use of Pickle and modules used to deserialize and serialize and trust data. If the tool detects that you are using Pickle in an unsafe way, it shows information, a report for if detects if you are using, for example, the load method in a YAML module, and this tool can be helpful for detecting these issues. It has also a plugin that specifically scans for methods listed in su process section that have the shell parameter equals true. At the completion of the testing, a report is generated that lists security issues identified within the target source code. This plugin looks for the use of a subprocess method using a command shell. It detects if the subprocess invocation is dangerous and is as it is vulnerable to various shell injection attacks. Also, the SQL plugin looks for strings that can be vulnerable and return SQL statements that are involved in some form of string building operation. This is another tool that I discovered in OpenStack. This tool is similar to Bandit. It's an automated API, but it works in a different way. Basically, it provides an API for security testing. Basically, aims to automatically detect common security defects such as SQL injection, LDAP injection, buffer overflow, and in addition, Syntribos can be used to help identify new security defects by automated fusing. This tool can be complement the Bandit tool that we have seen before, and well, it's an application that can complement because it has the capacity of discover other kind of vulnerabilities that maybe Bandit doesn't have. And finally, I'm going to comment in other security issues that we can find in Python. Since Python is writing in C, common security issues in C are related to the allocation of memory and buffer overflow errors in C. It's very common to find buffer overflows, problems of memory, and all these problems in Python can be found. CPython, for example, has had a number of overrun or overflow vulnerabilities over the years, each of which have been patched and fixed in subsequent release. For example, CPython in up to 2.7.13 is vulnerable to an integer overflow in the string decode escape function in a specific C file, string.object.c, resulting in a heap-based buffer overflow and the possibly arbitrary code execution. The other issues that we have, we can find in Python, for example, in the last year, have found malicious package that have been published in PyPy repository with similar names to popular package, but instead executing arbitrary code that can be malicious. For example, last year was found fake package for uRelief, Django server, setup tools, and so on. And this year have been identified 12 more Python libraries uploaded to the official repository. All the package were put together and worked following a similar pattern. For example, we can find a package for Django with Django where misspelling of Django framework, and this can be confused for the user. All these packages evidently are removed for the Python repository, but maybe in the future can happen similar issues. And finally, this is my personal repository, my GitHub repository, where we can find some of the samples that we have seen related with the command injection, flags, and so on. And these are reference for, these are the interesting reference for the OpenStack blog that have interesting articles for introduction in this topic.